My name is Konstantinos Petridis, and I am part of postdoctoral researcher in Decision Support Systems Laboratory of Production Engineering and Management School at the Technical University of Crete. I will try to be as short as possible and explain the model, because it's mostly a mathematical model. You will find some similarities with the previous presentation, because biomass supply chain consists of, in my presentation, I have consisted taking from two parts, from let's say agricultural products and from forest products. So this will include both of them. The content will be a short presentation, introduction, how the biomass supply chain is formulated, etc. Mathematical formulations, some results, conclusions, and bibliography. But starting from the first definition of renewable energy has started to be, or countries have started to switch to renewable energy in the last years or in the past years. Okay. In Greece, as well as in the European Union, this is not happening because of the environmental, I would say, attitudes of governments, rather than on the directive of EU called 2020, which is translated by 2020, 20% of the energy of a country should be produced by renewable energies. Okay. So this is pretty much how this in this graph how some types of renewable energies here have started to grow over the past over the years. For example, as you can see over there, this is in 1990. Okay, you could see that the share in let's say or the amount in millitons is that much, whereas in 2015 it has something like tripled. Okay. So again, if for example traditional forms of energy like wood and solid biofuel seem to have low contribution to primary energy production, okay. This one, overall, you know, the usage increase. Okay, so this is something that it explains the previous graph. The main problem when, for example, taking into account a model in renewable energies is not that simple. Otherwise, we would have already be using it. The main problem is that involves multiple stakeholders, okay, which is, for example, stakeholders that can speak and stakeholders that can't speak. For example, the stakeholders that can speak are us, okay, like individuals, etc. The ones that can't speak is, unfortunately, the natural resources, is, you know, the forest, etc. So we have to take these constraints into account, environmental constraints in specific. Okay, so there are generally, in order for a project to be sustainable, in the literature, there are three major types of let's say aspects that we need to take into account, which is economic, okay, social, and environmental. These are the three major ones. Now, going into the biomass supply chain network design, okay, let's take it from the top and we will try to break it down into small pieces. Generally, in the literature, these are the steps that the bioenergy or the energy from, let's say, biomass consists, which is, first of all, to take, it's actually supply chain. Supply chain is when we have something like a production and we move it to satisfy the final consumption or the demand. So in the first stage, it's the production from, let's say, agricultural products and forest products, okay? then we move it to storage because these products will have to be stored in specific humidity and other conditions under not protected from rain or outside or external factors. Then it should be pre-treated, especially for forest products. For example, the leaves should be taken away, etc. And then we have the energy conversion, when we have the biomass plants, okay, where they burn most of the times these two, and they produce energy. Of course, there are other types of, there is energy that is produced by other types of biomass products. For example, bioethanol from agricultural products or industrial crops, but this is not taken into account in this model or in this presentation. So, if we decompose this one into several different sub, I would say, operations, then, as I explained before, we have the production, where we have the forest management, and we have the energy crop management model. These two models provide the solutions or provide the quantities that would be moved into the second stage, which is warehousing and pretreatment, okay, where we have to warehouse, okay, we have to manage in an inventory or with an inventory management model how much should we store and how much should we, you know, move to the next step, which is the demand satisfaction, where we have the power production in order to satisfy the demand. Now, in the case where there is unsatisfied demand, this one has to be imported, stored, and then this circuit continues. The paper or the model that we have developed, and this is actually published. It's an amalgamation, or it decomposes from different models. Okay, for example, here we have already done this model in terms of forest production, and this one in terms of agricultural production model, and the global supply chain model, or the overall global supply chain model is actually decomposes of these models into a single framework. And these are the citations if someone or anyone wants to see how these models, what are these models. So this is an integrated framework, as I told you before, for production, warehousing, and demand satisfaction. It consists of several LP models, like linear programming models, and optimal quantities for biomass products are provided under constraints imposed by legislation, policy, and nature, of course, because, for example, in the case of forests, we cannot, you know, harvest or log without any restrictions. Otherwise, the forest itself will not be sustainable. So, regarding now the installation or the biomass supply chain. Okay, we have examined three types of, major aspects, which are the economic, for example, the profit in this case. We have social and environmental criteria. So this is in terms of, as you can see over here, if we try to decompose. Okay, the biomass supply chain, then we have the production, warehousing, and demand satisfaction under the three aspects, which are, economic, environmental, and social, which are the goals of our model. Okay. Now, regarding environmental could be, for example, the the tons of CO2 emissions that are not, okay, that are not emitted, okay, or if, on the other hand, it could be the tons or the kilograms of CO2 emitted through the operations of biomass supply chain. For example, when we are transporting these the first materials or the raw materials from one node to the other, then we are emitting through the trucks, etc., CO2. Then we have the economic. Okay, economic is, let's say, quite straightforward, because, for example, it could be or is the profit proxied by net present value or other economic, let's say, indicators in order to see whether this is economically viable or not. And finally, we have the social. Social could be or is proxied by indicators like jobs that are created through this type of activity, or by the GDP, let's say, by the GDP of a region or a town or any region that is affected from this economic activity. So, for example, if we are trying to make a supply chain network, then we have to install, let's say, a specific, I would say, plant, warehouse, etc., in those regions that are poorer than the others in order to boost the economy in this region, town, whatever. And some mathematics. For example, I don't know if any of you is familiar with multi-criteria decision making. This is actually a goal programming model. I have, this is only the goals, okay? The goals are, I have skipped the constraints because it would be quite massive, the presentation, it would be very hard to follow. So I kept on the goal constraints. Goal constraints, for example, in this case, when we are formulating a goal, is we have something like a left-hand side and the right-hand side. The left-hand side is, let's say, is decomposed or consists of this term, okay? And we have the deviation and variables. This term is that much, okay? Which is actually the cost to be minimized in this global or in this biomass supply chain, which is the, let's say, production cost or the transportation cost, okay? And this is the installation cost of a specific warehouse, and we have the input cost. And this one has to not, let's say, be more than or should be less than a goal that we set in order for the project to be viable. Again, we have something like environmental goals. The left-hand side, as you can see over here, is the objective function of a travel salesman problem. And finally, we have this one, which is the social. So once we solve that, the resulting model is a mixed indicator linear programming model with this objective function. So when we are dealing with multiple objectives, one should, you know, feed the model with some weights, because, for example, for one decision maker, the environmental should be or is greater than the economic, and the social is greater than the previous two. So if we are solving this model for multiple or all the combinations of weights, then we come to this, then we come to this type of results. For example, as long as the, this is the, this is the moment to see it from here, this is the, on the x-axis, the weight on the environmental criterion, and this is on the CO2 emissions, assuming that we have kept one criterion equal to zero, it doesn't matter to us, okay? So as long as we have more on the environmental, then as you can see over here, the CO2 reduces, because we are trying to reduce the number of CO2 emissions that are emitted from this, let's say, activity. It's the same over here. For example, as long as we increase the environmental criterion, then the cost, as you can see, decreases because we have less type of transportation. And this is something like a 2D representation, because we have two, as you can see over here, two types of information. We have the weight, we have the deviation variable, and this is the impact on the objective function. As you can see over here, the social is increasing in this type, in this region. Okay. And the same, I'm sorry, this was for, yes, isn't it for, is, yeah, no, I'm sorry, this is the economic and this is the social, okay? So, I'm moving to the conclusions part, okay? Generally, designing a supply chain or a biomass supply chain network is not an easy task. We cannot just put constraints, objective functions, and that solve it. We have to take multiple information from different stakeholders in order for this one to be sustainable. Our proposed model considers biomass products. It's especially from forests, okay, forest residues, timber, etc., and energy crops. And the design of biomass is very important, and is of course we have to take the seasonality, because as you can recall in the previous diagram that I presented, one of the problems that we have to face is seasonality. That's why we have to employ or take into account an inventory management model. Okay. So this is actually what I told before, that once the biomass is produced, it has to be stored in specific conditions. In most of the areas, in most of the cases, okay, biomass supply chain design is based on financial criteria, okay, based on maximization of profit or minimization of cost. However, there is, in such a venture, we have to take other aspects of a project into account. Okay, for example, in the social one, we have to take the GDP percentage of, or the employment rate, okay, or the number of jobs that will be created in the region that we're doing the activity. I would like to thank Greek State of Fellowships of Excellence for actually this is a presentation in this program. I would like to thank you for your attention. I hope that I was very, very short and precise, and I'm open to questions.
Thank you.